Hello, my name is Rafaël Rozendaal. I'm a visual artist working a lot with the internet. And this is a browser on a Mac computer in 2016. And we're going to visit a page that shows thumbnails of all my websites that I've made throughout the years with the help of others. And the point of this video is to have a simple recording of all these websites on one machine. So later, if they have to be restored, there's a reference of the intention and the playback speed and the interaction, and I can just simply explain in natural language what the work is supposed to do. So if somebody has to open up the code and there might be a confusion and there might be a different kind of input in the future, either on touchscreen or on whatever input device there will be in the future, and we can look at what the work was supposed to look like at the time and then conserve it for the future and understand the intentions, which makes it easier to restore. It's important to know that I consider these websites as living things that should be preserved in a dynamic way. What I mean is that I'm not nostalgic about hardware, so it doesn't mean that if this website is shown in the future that it should be shown on an original machine of 2016. I want the work to grow. So traditionally, artwork deteriorates, but I like the idea that code can adapt over time and get better. So playback speed will get better, resolution will get better, and then hopefully color displays will be better. The work will just look better in the future. That's my hope. And for that reason, now we're recording this video. So let's begin browsing. The first website I made was called whitetrash.nl, and you see my face. Most of my websites are purely vector, meaning they're all line images, but in this case, the first thing I made in Flash, there's a PNG file of my face on a yellow background, and there's a background sound playing, there's a little music loop, and if you click my hair, you can browse different haircuts, and you can browse different eyewear, different facial hair. So this video, I'm not explaining the work, I'm not giving you any interpretation, this is just a technical run through what it does. In this case, Flash will scale the work proportionately, so it always fills up the browser. So it's important for me to always think about how the browser is filled, because the browser is different on everybody's device and everybody's personal preferences. So the composition is flexible, which is something we'll see later, I'll get into more. But that's just when you make internet work, you have to think about different screen sizes. The next work is MrNiceHands.com. You hear a background sound and you see two hands. One hand is pointing a finger and the other one is about to pull the finger. There's the American expression, pull my finger. And if you click one of the two hands, the right hand grabs the left hand and there's a farting sound. And there's about a library of 8 or 12, I don't remember exactly, different fart sounds that it chooses randomly. And if the fart sound is short, it will only hold the finger for a short time. If the fart sound is longer, it will hold it as long as that fart lasts. So the interaction is quite simple. And again, it scales. Because it's vector, it can scale without loss of resolution. Up to a point. If you keep scaling, you see the end of the hands, which is kind of messy, but so be it. I was lazy at the time, I'm sorry. One thing to note is that I drew these hands by hand and I scanned them and I vectorized them, but I didn't do a good job. So if you zoom in, you see that it was kind of a low resolution scan that was traced in a sort of clumsy way. So if anyone in the future wants to clean this up, then please do. On current screens, it's not visible at this resolution, so I never bother to update it. And then things like this, where at an extreme resolution or an extreme browser setting, but not many people will browse with a browser window like this, so I don't consider it a real problem. It's these are just considerations. I could try to make every website absolutely perfect, but that would be a loss of time, so that there's a limit. The next website is stagnationmeansdecline.com. It's in the collection of Christophe Boutin. And what we see is stacks of dollars that are growing, that are moving upwards. And the way it's made is that I made one graphic of one stack of dollars. This work was originally made in Flash and was recoded in HTML5 or JavaScript. So there are all these stacks, and to make it run smoother, the next stack is not actually on top of the old one. It's all the stacks are at the stage at the same time, and their position in the depth in the z-axis is just manipulated. So the graphics are already there, it's just flipping them. This is where you'll hear that I'm not a coder, so I'm trying to explain it in simple language because I didn't code this piece. This was the first piece where I animated it in Flash to begin with, but as you can see, that just one stack of dollars is already a lot of lines. So I made the graphic in Flash and started animating it, and I made the stack of dollars, then repeated it so it fills the screen, and then I made maybe 8 layers, and to animate it, I just started deleting the layers stack by stack and just making a frame by frame animation. And I ran into the problem that there were so many lines on the stage that it had to render every frame, and you wanted to do this in real time, and it just became painfully slow. So to every frame to think about all these stacks, a full screen of stacks times 8, it was just too much to handle for the computer. It was 3 to 5 seconds between each frame. So I met Rainier Feyen, and we were talking about this, and he said, oh, there's a better way of doing this, where you only have all the dollars once to fill the whole screen, and you just dynamically assign the depth of each graphic, and that way you make a solution that you don't have so many lines active on the screen. So he programmed this, and also because of programming, you can add the concept of randomness, which you cannot do if you do it frame by frame. So that way, I always say that the piece becomes more like a waterfall, which a waterfall keeps doing the same thing, but it never repeats itself. So the idea here is that the randomness makes the piece somewhat unpredictable. You'll know that the dollars will always grow, but you don't know where the next one grows. So that was the technical solution. Technically, in JavaScript, I'm not even sure. In Flash, I know the way they were on the stage. In JavaScript, it's a little bit different. So this is not about the exact code execution and whether the screen temporarily caches it as a bitmap and places new graphics on top. But I'm just talking about what it should do. And so what it should do is it should keep adding this graphic of the stacks of dollars randomly on a different place, sometimes two at the same time. And if you look at the code, you'll see my intended frame rate in milliseconds. But if you just look at this video, it will just kind of give you this pace. This is the pace that I'm comfortable with right now. It can be a bit slower or a bit faster depending on the machine, so there's a margin. But it shouldn't be so fast that you can't follow it anymore. So here you can kind of follow, but it's also faster that you can't really comprehend. If it was a lot slower, it would be too easy to follow. So it's kind of a border between not easy to follow and easy to follow. The next piece is called whywashesad.com from 2003. It's in the collection of Miltus Monetas. And what happens is there's a background sound and there's clouds passing, some from left to right and some from right to left. And if you move your cursor, the clouds disappear and they make a sound. There's about 8 event sounds that it chooses randomly, and it chooses randomly where the next cloud comes from. So at what height the next cloud comes. That's random. The speed is a bit random. So some move faster, some move slower. and then the moment you touch them, they disappear and new clouds come from the side. So the idea is that you can never really clear the screen. So the speed should be, in a sense, the speed should be that a normal user, if a normal user is deleting clouds, that it's kind of at the edge of what's possible. So that if the user really tries, like I'm really trying now to clear the screen, I can almost, that's the point here, is that you can almost empty the screen. So maybe someone who's very good at using a mouse can empty it completely. On a touch screen, this piece is not in JavaScript yet, it's just in Flash, so you won't see it on a touch screen so much, but on a touch screen it would be easier to clear the screen. The next website is a non-interactive one called imveryverysorry.com, and we see a graphic with the words "I am very, very sorry," and then it's mirrored, so it looks like a reflection, and then drops of water fall from outside of the screen onto a plane, and when they fall they make a sound, and there's a random group of drop sounds, so there's a little bit different sound every time it drops. And then when it drops, there's a circle animation. It's a squashed circle, so it becomes an oval. And one thing that's important to note is that the oval fades in opacity from 100% to zero as it grows, and the circle line is always 1 pixel. On future screens, you might have to adapt that to 2 pixels. So the stroke width of the circle. And it's important that if the circle grows, that the stroke width doesn't grow with it, so that the stroke width is always 1 pixel, no matter the size of the circle. The next website is called wewillattack.com from 2002. I just showed the clouds. I think it was from 2001. Because it's here behind 2002, so it might be an error here that it says 2003. This website is from 2002, and we see a gradient. It's random, so every time you load the website, it's a different one. There's a selection of about 10 or 12 colors, and then when you click once, you have a beginning point of a line, and you can move the mouse around, and if you click again, it will make a gradient between the 2 points that you just assigned. So if I do it this way, the gradient will be in this direction. It can be sideways or top to bottom or diagonal. And it just chooses 2 colors randomly. You have no control over that. If you do it very short, you get it. And it was made in Flash. I was thinking about how to make this for a touchscreen because you have the 10 fingers instead of 1 pointer, so I have not made that yet. And that's something that future input devices, the piece will have to be reinterpreted a little bit, and you can look at the intention of the work and then replicate it in a way that makes sense for that type of input. Some pieces we already converted to HTML5 or JavaScript, and some pieces we still have to do. This is everything you see is in the past.com. This is an almost not interactive website. What we see is there's a library of shapes that I made. I'm not sure how many, but about 20 shapes. And randomly at points on the screen, shapes start to grow. If you click, it starts from zero again, and so you see it chooses random positions and it chooses a random shape, and the shape starts to grow. The shape grows, but the content is fixed in size. So that way the shape is a mask, it's not a shape that has a content that stretches with the shape. So the idea is that the movement of the content and the movement of the shape itself are contradictory, and that way the shapes behave more like masks than as objects. And sometimes the shapes shrink again and new shapes appear. It's in the collection of Hotel Amistad in Barcelona. The next website is called onandoff.org from 2003. And we see a switch. It has a one and a zero. It's on and off. And if you touch the switch, it moves. There's just two frames. And you hear a sound that just sort of emulates a classic button. And that's all it does. There's no no other function to the button other than that it listens to you. But it does. The button doesn't have any consequences other than that it moves itself. This was made in, it's like most websites that I showed, this is a vectorized button, which means that you can show it at any size and it will scale proportionately. The next website is called Fatal to the Flesh in the collection of Miltus Manetas. It starts with a white screen, and then when you drag your mouse, which means you press down and move, if you just tap, nothing happens. But if you drag, you cut the screen and blood comes out. And if you drag quickly, if you make a fast movement, you'll just see one segment. If you do it slowly, you'll see multiple segments. So every so many seconds, the intervals in the code, it checks your position and makes a line between those two points. And if you move fast, the width of the gash is a little bigger. If you move slow, it's thinner and it's more segments. And if you move fast, there's a bigger chance of a drop of blood. And if you move slow, there will hardly be blood. So it's a little bit like a drawing tool, but with blood instead of just a line. It's a drawing tool, I would say, that is to create straight pieces. It's not a free-form drawing tool. You cannot just... And this was to emphasize the idea of cutting, because you usually use a knife to make straight lines. The next website is The End of Reason. It's based on a Liechtenstein painting called Seascape Number 2. The original painting is in color, but I found the painting in a black and white book, and I thought to animate it because the Bende dots are very static, and then I'm animating the surroundings of the Bende dots, but they stay in place. So in this case, there are sine functions with the randomness aspect. There's different points that describe the line, and they move from some of the lines move from left to right, and others move from right to left. And this is a piece that the content was actually in bitmaps. It had better performance. We tried it first in with vector content, but it was too difficult for computers at the time. But the resolution is quite high, so you don't notice the pixels of the bitmap. But in the future, if it's restored, the Bende dots could easily be coded in vector. I think the computer would be fine. If you scale it this way, you see the edges. You're not supposed to see that, so that's a mistake. But usually people don't browse like this. So the work adapts. Its proportions stay the same. And if you make a very narrow browser, it just cuts off left and right. There's no ideal size to watch the work. It's whatever the user wants. The next website is itwillneverbethesame.com. We see an abstraction or a simplified version of a road at night, a landscape, and if you press, you give a little bit of gas, as if you step on the gas of the car, and if you hold it, you start driving. And the idea of driving is simulated by a line in the middle of the road and a little bit of trembling. The faster you go, the more it shakes. And everything shakes, even the stars, which doesn't make sense, but it just gave the best suggestion of movement. And so if you hold the mouse down, you're just driving straight. If you hold it down and move the mouse to the right, the road turns to the right, so you can keep driving. If you move the road to the left, the road turns to the left. So it's like a driving game that adapts to your needs instead of it asking you where to go. The way it was made is that I drew this scene in a 3D program and then traced all the frames. So I traced all the frames from left to right and copied that from right to left. And then it just goes to those frames. And I think this line was created dynamically. I'm not sure how it was done in code, but this is what it's supposed to look like. And the next website is nosquito.biz in the collection of Sebastian de Ganay from 2005. This is an interactive website that's completely black. And if you move the mouse, you hear the sound of a mosquito. And if you stop, you don't hear anything. So what we see is there's no image whatsoever. The only image is the mouse cursor. So this is typically a website that doesn't make sense to convert for touchscreen because there's no cursor on the touchscreen. In this case, to suggest the movement of a mosquito, originally I thought I should make something in the interaction that there's a very nuanced relationship between the sound and the movement of the cursor, but it turned out that pause and play was enough and that your mind thinks you're creating all these subtleties, but all it does is it presses, when you move, it turns the sound on, and when you stop moving, it turns the sound off. And there's a slight fade at the end so that it's not a too hard of a cut. So it doesn't matter if you move very fast or very slow. There is a stereo effect. So if you move this way, it'll be more on the right channel. If you move this way, it'll be more on the left channel. The next website is pleasetouchme.com. And it's an interactive depiction of a hand. It's a line drawing of a hand, and I filmed a hand and then traced all the frames, about 50 frames from the finger being here to the finger being here. So as I'm dragging my mouse, it's just going through this movie clip with all the different positions of this finger. And this line in between the fingers is dynamically generated. So this finger is cut off here, and then this part is generated, and this fill is generated up to here. So there's five independent timelines that can move independently, and if I pull the finger down, after a certain time, it will just automatically go back up. So this is, again, you have control over the hand somewhat, but the hand also moves on its own outside of your control. The next website is muchbetterthanthis.com. It's in the collection of Almar van der Krocht and Margot, his wife. It's from 2006. And what we see is two silhouettes of two people kissing. It's a loop. Most of my websites are not loops, but this one is. The movement is a loop. The colors are not a loop. So I made points on the timeline. I filmed these two people kissing and traced all the frames, and then I made points on the timeline, which I consider the kissing points. And at that point, there's a fade in one of them. It changes color. So if you look, you'll see exactly at the moment of kissing, one of the faces changes color. And then again, usually I work with a set list of colors. So I rarely work with random colors, because if you choose random colors, it's sort of a predictable randomness in the sense that if colors are random, it ends up being kind of gray or non-saturated colors. It's very rare the chance that you get a saturated color if you're just randomly picking from the full spectrum. So I want to define a number of colors. But in the eight colors that were used here, the selection of colors is random. But there is a function that makes sure that the left and the right face don't have the same color at the same time. And to show you the scaling, this is again a work that scales proportionately and up to a point. If you watch it on mobile, it'll look like this, probably on a phone. And on most people's screens, it will look like this. So it adapts to whatever potential space there is. And yeah, that's it with this piece. Okay, the next website is papertoilet.com. It's in the collection of Sebastian de Ganet. And we see a roll of toilet paper that you can re-roll or unroll. I can pull on it, and as I pull on it, you'll see the roll get smaller. It takes a while, but you can completely unroll the whole roll of toilet paper. So let's do that now. It's going to take some time, but might as well, just so you can see the ending. This website also remembers where you left off. So if you close the website and revisit it, this is where the toilet paper was when you left it. So you can continue. You can roll back and the roll will get bigger. But if you get to the end, then the toilet paper is gone and it's just a black screen. And many people ask me online, I ran out of toilet paper. The trick is if you want a new roll, you double click. And not a lot of people found out. I think double clicking is unnatural on the internet, so people didn't think about it. The next website is viavanti.com from 2006. And we see a landscape. It looks like you're flying over a hilly landscape. And the landscape is made by the graphic representations of hills. There's 8 or 12 basic shapes that I drew. And those shapes have a vertical movement. They go up and then they go down. And as that happens, they also scale up. And the script randomly chooses one of the 8 hills, or one of the 12, and then chooses whether it shows them regular or flipped from left to right. That way you have a bit more variation. And then it chooses one out of a number of colors, I think 8 or 12 colors. I usually work with the pre-selected colors because then I have more control over the image. I think that random colors have a very predictable look. Like a lot of digital art, a lot of random generative images tend to work with completely random colors, and it kind of gives a bland result. And I think if you select colors yourself, you have more of a character in the work. For example, the black here is not 100% black. It's maybe 90% black. So that way you just, in my view, you get more value, not value, you get more a characteristic. And I like to choose colors that work on any monitor. So these colors are very, they have a lot of contrast, and they're very high in saturation. And so I don't want to work with colors that are too subtle, because on some devices or some screens, they would disappear. And this work scales disproportionately with any aspect ratio, and it squeezes the work. So you can view it any way you want. The viewer can decide on the way he or she wants to see the work. The next website is biglongnow.com. We hear a doorbell, and you can open the door. You can open the door by dragging the doorknob. But behind this door is another door. And behind that is another door. These are just copies of the same movie clip. So as you drag, you're just basically going through the timeline of that movie clip. And when the doors hit each other, they move and you hear a sound. This is a vector image, so you can scale it at any size. This work does scale with the same ratio. So the doors always have the same ratio. They wouldn't, in some animations, I think it's okay that they get squashed or squeezed. And in some animations or some websites, I think that it's better because a door has a certain proportion. And if the door would become very wide, you wouldn't understand it's a door anymore. So in every work in the script, there's an indication of how the work should scale. But now I'm just explaining that in common language. And so there's a between all these doors, there's a script that says, if I hit it very hard, it'll move that far, and if I hit it gently, it'll just move a little bit. So there's those sort of physics laws that you make, where you say, okay, this door has that much mass, so the movement of this door affects it that much. That's something that whenever I make a work, I work with the programmer and make a storyboard, and then the programmer makes a prototype, and I can change all kinds of values in that prototype. And some of those values are how much the next door breaks the movement of the previous door. The next website is futurephysics.com. This website, you see a number of planets that are floating around. The viewer is the sun, so the planets are revolving around you. So if I take a planet and throw it here, it'll come back on this side. It's not doing that now. Maybe it takes a while. Oh, there it is. That's the planet that I just threw. So if I throw it back that way, it'll come out here in a second. And when the planets hit each other, they make a sound. You can take the planets and bounce them off of each other and throw it around. And the stars in the background, there's two layers of stars. One is moving right to left and the other one is moving left to right to give a sort of spatial illusion, a three-dimensional feeling. The next website is flamingcursor.com. This was actually a found script. There was a website with tons of examples of flash scripts, and this was a script of a flaming cursor, and I liked it very much, and I thought it fit my body of work, so I emailed the author, and I asked him, can I show this as a ready-made? And he said, sure. So I believe, no, it's not in the description. I don't remember the name of the author, but I can find it for you. And the script I didn't make, but I found it very beautiful. It's about 8 frames of flames and about 8 frames of smoke, and there's a sort of a delay in how they follow the mouse. If you move very quickly, you see the different frames, and they sort of they pause for a second and then move upward. This is brokenself.com. We start with a white screen, nothing to see, and you can move your mouse, nothing happens. But if you click, you break the screen as such. And you can click multiple times also. When you have the white screen, you break it, and there's a black screen behind it. When you are on the black, it goes back to white, so you keep flipping between the two. And the breaking is just a frame-by-frame animation. I drew the whole grid of broken parts and then just frame-by-frame deleted parts from the bottom all the way to the top. This is, and then as they move, they also move down, so they're not static, they fall, meaning that the pieces here start to drop sooner, and then here, and then here, and then here. So, let's see. And there's sound of glass breaking as well. The clicking is, whenever you click, there's a graphic, just a linear representation of the breaking from the point where you click, and one of the pieces falls, so the script recognizes where your mouse is and takes out, because the animation in the background, the full breaking animation, is linear. It's a frame by frame animation. It's not dynamic. So to create the relationship between the clicking and the linear animation, one of the pieces that you touch will disappear first. So that's where my mouse was. And if I hit it here, so this first line animation has nothing to do with the background, but that piece that falls out first, it does. The next animation, sorry for calling it animation. The next website is called jellotime.com. And it's a interactive representation of a jello dessert. So we see a shape of a dessert that's kind of transparent on a blue plate, a red dessert on a blue plate. I created a little bit of transparency to give you the feeling of the jello dessert. It's one of the few desserts that's kind of transparent. And if you move your mouse, the dessert starts to move. And depending on the direction of your mouse, it'll move in that direction. It'll wobble. And it also makes a sound. So the whole image is built up out of many different parts. And I animated basically five directions. I animated the direction this way, horizontal, vertical, and two diagonals. So that's, four directions. And if I touch the jello here, we have the sideways movement. If I touch the jello here, we have the up and down movement. Diagonal one, diagonal two. And so there's a point zero for all directions, and the point zero is the same for all the directions. That's this, that's the silent, quiet position. And then there are extremes of each movement, and whenever it hits back to zero, it can also go to another direction. The next work is popcornpainting.com. So what we see is there's a collection of popcorn kernels, and they move upward. It's a bit the idea that you are inside a pan where popcorn is made, and it's all around you. And there's a loud sort of bass sound to suggest the fire or whatever is causing the things to pop, and then there's the popping sound, and then they move in a random way, and at the same time they push each other a little bit here at the bottom. So they're pushing the other ones around, and the ones that get pushed aside only move a little bit. They'll move in this area, but the big ones that are causing the other ones to push are moving all the way up, and they move out of the screen. And when you click, you pause the whole work. And when you click again, the work continues. This is typically a piece that uses many layers of sound. So there's the background layer, and there's different event sounds, the different pops. The big problem with JavaScript so far on mobile is that it's not good at playing multiple sound events at the same time. You can only play one sound at a time. That's kind of a rule on mobile. So I'm not sure if that will be solved in the future, but for now this piece would be hard to run on HTML5 on a mobile device. And for that reason, we have not spent time yet converting this to HTML5, because if it doesn't run on mobile, then there's no need to convert it yet. This is leduchamp.com in the collection of Jan Oehmann. This is a digital representation of a work by Marcel Duchamp, The Bicycle Wheel, which I think is one of the first interactive artworks that I know of. But it's always in a museum and you can't touch it, so I thought to make a digital version that you can touch it. And so when you grab the wheel and rotate it, you can by dragging it, you can rotate it, and it makes a sound if you spin it. And the shadow moves along with it. The next website is colorflip.com, a collection of Sébastien de Ganet. We see a monochrome website. The color is random. Every time you refresh, you get another color. It's a list of, again, 8 to 12 colors. I always have a list of colors. And when you move to the corners of the website, you see the suggestion of a page curl. It's a common web design trope for photo albums. And instead of it being a photo album where you flip through photos, in this sense you flip through colors. And if I move to the corner, it sticks to my mouse. And then I can, now I'm only moving the mouse, I'm not dragging. So this is just a hover state. And then if I drag, I can pull it all the way. I can also pull it back, and then I can drag it, and I keep flipping new sheets of paper. And I can do that in any corner, or I can also do it from the side. If I hold my mouse in the middle and just click, it will also flip. So that way you can really go fast. This was a work where we spent a lot of time working on the settings, in a sense that we're emulating or representing a physical property, the flipping pages, and to make it really feel like paper, it just took a long time of thinking, how fast does it follow the mouse? How hard is the sound? How much can I drag it? So it's really important to understand the feeling of, for the user to get the feeling that it's not leather, it's not air, it's really paper. It just takes a while to play with the settings. The next work is called void.com. It's a spider web, and you can grab any of the pieces of the spider web. If I drag here, nothing happens if I'm in between. But if I grab any of the nodes or the web itself, you can move it around. And if you pull really hard, it snaps. So there's a bunch of nodes, and if I make the distance between the nodes very far, the pieces in between snap. And so I can keep pulling until the whole web falls down. As you can see, there's a gravity simulation. So everything falls down, and you can just keep going till the whole work is at the bottom of the screen. And that's it. The next up is a number of cursor studies. So mosquito.biz and flaming cursor, this is a continuation, even more reduced. This is invisiblecursor.com, so it's a white website and your cursor disappears. There's no cursor anymore. This script this is a flash script. I think you can also do it in CSS. Just if there's a mouse cursor, it just hides it. That's all that happens. The next website is tinycursor.com. So if you move your mouse, you just have a very small cursor. I'm not sure if this will be visible very well in this video, but the whole mouse is just a few pixels. I think it's 4 pixels. Might be hard to see in video. I'll jump to the next cursor study. This is annoyingcursor.com. Sometimes you have to move the... Okay, this piece is very hard to explain if you're not using the mouse. But what happens is it's hiding the actual cursor and replacing it by a graphic. And this graphic moves the opposite direction that you move. So if you move to the right, the cursor moves to the left. If you move your mouse to the left, it's the opposite, and the diagonal and top and down. So it's just the reversal of your cursor behavior. This is aestheticecho.com. It's a non-interactive website. It's a sort of a landscape that you would see if you take the train in the Netherlands and look outside. What happens is there's a linear perspective. There's a suggestion of the sky with a gradient horizontally. And then there's a horizon and there's planes. So there's an infinite plane that you're scrolling past, that you're panning, and every so many intervals, it's dissected into different planes. So in the settings, you can see, okay, every so many pixels change color. And then on those color areas, there's even different rectangles. So first, it's just, if you would look at this landscape from the top, you would just see a long stretch of color cut into pieces by a line like this, and then there's rectangles on top, and then there's shapes on top. And then they just move three-dimensionally in a script. It's important to note that all the lines that I use usually are sharp lines, they're vector imagery, and that a lot of 3D software is bitmap-based. So we tried making this in a 3D software, in something like WebGL, but then all the lines are blurry, which I don't like. That's just a personal preference, but so I don't know in the future if this has to be recoded. It could be recoded in a 3D environment, but 3D environments tend to not produce sharp lines because they're based on textures, and this is a lack of textures, just filled in with color, and usually 3D software doesn't give you this kind of visual result. The next website is beefchickenpork.com. We see a pink area and a blue area, and we see a shape on the right. So I can grab that shape and drag it to the left. If I let go of it, it will move a little bit. And when it crosses the middle line, in that area, a new shape will appear. So it's a bit like for me, this is a diagram of the digestion. So it's digesting the shape and converting it to something else. Please note that the middle line is not exactly straight. It's a small angle. And then there's a library of about 25 shapes. And you can just keep dragging them to left and right to go through all of them. The next website is electricboogiewoogie.com. It's based on a painting by Piet Mondrian, the Dutch abstractionist. And his painting, it was a flyover view of Manhattan, but it's a painting, so it doesn't move. And this is the animated version. And it's not animated, it's scripted. So there are traffic rules. This is actually a piece where I don't even know exactly what's going on. The programmer, Renier, spent a lot of time on the traffic rules. So there's some sort of system where if the car goes this way, there's a traffic light, so it has to wait for that car. And this car has to wait for that car. And there's roads that every road you can only go in one direction. But you can find all these things in the code. The next website is hybridmoment.com. It's a website that's a stylization or abstraction of an explosion, referencing Looney Tunes cartoons. This is actually a straight copy from the Roadrunner. He blows himself up a lot of times, and I just traced those explosions and turned that into a script. So what happens here is there's about a number of 8 or 20 basic shapes of these star shapes, and they grow from the middle. And if your cursor is in the corner of the website, as far away from the middle as possible, it's the maximum speed. And the closer the cursor is to the middle, the slower the speed. So you're controlling the speed of the explosion. And one thing that's important to know is that the scaling of these star shapes is not linear. It's not a straight scaling. There's an ease. I always forget which one is ease in and which one is ease out. But if they moved in a linear, if they grow in a linear way, they start overlapping each other. So I made it in a way with the ease that the optically the distance between the graphics, between the star shapes, is the same all the time. So it feels like the distance between them is the same. When it goes at full speed, I think you can hardly see what the distance is between them. The next website is hotdoom.com. It's in the collection of Axel Nordin. We're waiting for it to load. This website currently is both in Flash and HTML5. We made a 3D model of a volcano in a 3D program and made 4 renderings of it. So there was a physics script that emulated the movement, liquid movement out of a hole onto a sort of pyramid mountain. And we output those 4 timelines and trace them in Flash. So it has this rough vector tracing aesthetic. And then the shapes are filled with blinking colors to suggest the fiery nature of lava. If you click, I'm clicking now. So it's 4 movie clips on top of each other. No, wait, there's 4 movie clips that it can choose from. And whenever you click, it plays one of those movie clips. If you just wait, there's a bigger interval, but you can speed it up by clicking. And so basically, you're just putting movie clips on top of each other. When I say movie clip, it's the full movement from 0 to the end of the lava. And then you can have a maximum number of them on top of each other. Otherwise, the computer would get confused. It's too heavy for the computer. So we had to set a limit there. And then you basically speed it up by clicking a lot. So basically you're causing explosions with your mouse clicks of the volcano. The next work is from the darkpass.com. This is again a flyover of a sort of polygonal planet or landscape. All the polygons are filled with a number of grayscale colors, maybe about 7 instances between black and white. They're just randomly chosen. There's not really a direction in the light. And you hear the sound of a helicopter, but distorted, in the background. And if I click, then the light is directional. It's like you're in a helicopter and there's a spotlight on the planet and your mouse is directing where the light goes. And there's more of a three-dimensionality to the light. Here there's not really a three-dimensionality to the light, it's just random. And this way you see more a direction of the light. The next website is closedshut.com. We see an image of a vault. This is an example where you see how the scaling is controlled. So the scaling of the sides is proportional. The scaling of this plane in the middle is non-proportional. And then these elements are proportional. So it's sort of the different elements scale differently. So that on any screen, it gives a somewhat, on any screen, it gives a reasonable vault. And on this vault, you can try to unlock it by searching for a code. And then you can try if that code was correct. I'm not going to give you the code now. You can just spend time trying to unlock it. So you can move this left and right, and there's gentle clicks. And then when you drag this up or down, there's a heavier sound to suggest that you haven't found the code yet. The next website is deepblackhole.com in the collection of Sébastien de Ganet. We see a hole in the floor and a horizon in the back to suggest the depth, and we see a rock. And you can move the rock around, and there's a shadow on the floor. And if you lift the rock up, the shadow goes further a little bit and fades out into zero opacity. Then you can drop it again. If you throw the rock to the side of the screen, it comes out the other way. And then if you throw the rock, if you just drop it into the hole, it falls at the bottom. If you double click, you get a new rock, or it might be the same rock, we don't know. One thing that's difficult here is the input is two-dimensional, but the suggestion of depth is three-dimensional. So that's something that took a long time to figure out. And I don't even remember how we did it exactly, but the rock is not scaling as I move it to the back or to the front. We decided not to do that. The rock is always the same size. The next website is intotime.com. It's one of the first works where I reached an interest in fully abstract work and based on rules. And so the rule here is that any plane of this website is filled with pulsing gradients. So pulsing, I mean, there's a left point and a right point, and those two points keep fading between the next random color and the next random color, random chosen from a list. And then if I click in the middle, I cut the screen in half. And those two planes are filled with different pulsing gradients. I can click here. If I click a little bit at the bottom, it'll produce a line here. If I click in this area, it'll produce a line here. So I'm clicking here, it made a line here. If I click here, it makes a line here. If I click more on this side, it will create a line here. You don't have full control, so it's really just meant to click around until you see a composition you like. if you click on the line itself, that line will disappear. And so you see this opens up a little bit. If I click on this line, this area opens up. If I click here, this opens up. If I click here, that opens up. So you can go back to zero this way. You can also go back to zero by refreshing on the browser. Hit refresh. And so this is a compositional study where the user decides on the final composition that they see. And it's based on halves and halves and halves, either horizontal or vertical. The next website is ringingtelephone.com. It's just the sound of a telephone ringing. And that's all that happens. It's not interactive, there's no image, it's just a telephone ringing. Necromisanthrope.com is a flashing animation. It's triangles that scale. They're big on the left and they get narrower on the right. And at the same time, the website is blinking between negative and positive. So black background and white foreground, it's switching the black and the white. This is actually a linear animation. It's just a loop. Not very complicated. Okay, the next website is The Persistence of Sadness. What we see is these shapes that sort of look like rocks. This was actually a website where I had to use bitmaps because I'm using gradient meshes. There are gradients with multiple points, and I couldn't do that in Flash or JavaScript. So these are just bitmaps, but the masking shape is vector, so there's always a sharp line at the edge. And if I click any of those shapes here, these rocks, the rock disappears, and the rocks on top fall down. When the rocks hit the bottom of the screen, or when they hit each other, the whole image of the entire website shakes a little bit. And they keep trying to fit, there's a gravity, and they will look at any potential space and try to squeeze in there. Right now, there's a hole here because probably the stone above is bigger than it doesn't fit through here. So if I click on this rock right here, it'll disappear, and the ones on top fall down. Well, yeah. This rock went up a little bit because of the pressure of these side rocks. This is tothewater.com. We see a glass of water, and if I move the cursor up or down, the sound changes, the pitch of the tone. And if I touch the glass, it changes position. And it's gone. It moves away from me. So I can never touch the glass. The next website is Flaming Log. We see a log or a graphic representation of a log. And it's a masked vector shape filled with a bitmap image. Bitmap really meaning black or white. And the anti-aliasing is turned off in this website. That's something you can control in Flash. And then I took the flame from Flaming Cursor and put that on top. But since vector images, you can just scale any way you want, but a bitmap is a little different. And because if this was anti-alias, there would be a lot more different grays inside the tree bask. But here I wanted it to be purely black and white. If I zoom in, in Flash, you can right-click and then zoom in. So you see the bitmap texture. So I'm not sure in any next web environment if you can control anti-aliasing or not, but that was something you could in Flash. We're looking at yesforsure.com. It's a representation or a depiction of the ocean seen from above. It's the sea landing on the sand. And so all that happens is we have the color of the sand here, and then we have a graphic that goes from white to either green or blue, and it moves this way and changes opacity. It fades out, and at the same time it plays the sound of a wave crashing. The next website is towardsandbeyond.com. It's a three-dimensional maze. So every time I click in the middle, I get closer. And if I click on the side, I'll turn that to the right. If I click on the right, I turn to the right. If I click on the left, I turn to the left. And now to show you, the maze keeps randomizing. So if I turn three times, four times, I'll come back here and I'll have to see a pink square. So click once, twice, three, four. Now it's a blue square. So the maze keeps regenerating as it's out of vision. So this is not regenerating because we're looking at it, but the things that happen behind you, every time it's shown, it's regenerating. And that way the maze can never be solved. So you can move up or down. It's really, you can move in any direction you want. It's just mouse control. There's also some cursor control, but I never explicitly told people, but with the cursor you can, there's a bit of cheating, but I'm not gonna go into that now. That was basically for testing, but I just left it in. So the playback speed of all my works should be as smooth as possible. We might have scripted them at 30 frames per second at the time because computers were not so fast. Now they're usually scripted at 60 frames a second. If the future, the computer can easily handle 120 frames per second, I'm for that, as smooth as possible, or 1200 frames or 12,000, whatever the future is. If the resolution keeps going up, I'm also all for that. So if in the future we have 20K screens, then if this animation, this movement and this interaction can really work well at 20,000 pixels, a 20K screen and 12,000 frames per second and whatever the future is, I'm all for it. I'm not nostalgic about this screen right now. I really see this as an instruction that should be played on the next technology. But this playback speed is the way I like it. The next website is called Burning My Time, and we see shapes moving across the screen and we hear the sound of cars. So what happens is there's a graphic of a car. It's a rectangle that fades from one color to transparent, and it moves very quickly so you hardly see it, and it picks a random color every time, and it picks a random direction and a random interval, and then basically you're looking at a road from above and cars are passing by. The next website is goodbyefarewell.com, and it's a suggestion of a moon at night and a water surface, and the water is moving a little bit, so it's altering the reflection of the moon. There's no interaction, and the movement is completely scripted, so it's very random. If you look at the movement, there's basically two lines here in perspective, the two diagonal lines, one here and one here. And on that line, there are points that keep wobbling across, but at a random speed. So some points are moving further, some points are moving less far. You might think it's interactive, but it's not. It's just going on its own. A lot of times people think something is interactive because they're moving their mouse, and sometimes it is and sometimes it isn't, but it's the effect of when you have an arcade machine in an arcade hall and it's in demo mode and you don't have money to put coins in, but little kids will just move the joystick thinking that they're playing the game. This is lovegameset.com. It's a non-interactive tennis game without players. So there's a ball that is being tennised around. The tennis players are out of the frame, I guess. and we don't hear them, we don't see them, we just hear the ball bouncing. And the script is also keeping track of the score. So there's the love and 15 and 30, 45 game, and there's sets. So if you just let it play, it's playing an actual match by the rules. There's a background graphic of the court on a green background, and then there's a ball, which is just a white circle, and there's a drop shadow of the ball on the floor. And if the ball is higher, the shadow is further from the ball, to suggest the height of the ball, according the height of the ball, how far it's away from the floor. This website is sadforjapan.com in the Borisan collection. It's a circle that wobbles. There's different points on the circle, and it responds to your mouse. And the circle is filled with a pulsing gradient with red, pink, and white. And if you wobble your mouse, there's a sort of water sound. The more you move around, the more... It's a bit like a floating piece of liquid in space that you can touch and wobble. The next website is tossingturning.com. We see a circle and a sort of lemon in a room. And there's a background sound. And if I move my mouse, either the lemon grows or the circle grows. They never grow together. And the background's colors change. When you move, there's also a sort of reversed violin sound that plays. If you don't move, you just hear a background noise. Next website is fallingfalling.com. I'm muting the sound. There's a background sound, which is a shepherd loop, which gives you the illusion that the tone is continually dropping. It's an audio illusion. And at the same time, the image that we see, basically, it's taking the size of the browser, the way it is at that moment, and taking the edges, and then moving the edges towards the bottom. But it's taking it takes the corner points of the rectangle, but it also randomly allocates a few other points. And those points fall down at slightly different speeds. So that way you get a dynamic shape instead of just a rectangle shrinking. And then when the shape falls, it fades from one color to the other. It's moving quite fast, so it's hard to see. But if you follow one of the colors, you see it changing color as it falls. And so it's continually randomly choosing colors from a list. And this is really like a waterfall. The next website is intertime.org, which is a continuation of intertime.com, a collection of Sima Famillant. And in intertime.com, the cuts were horizontal and vertical, and in this case, they're diagonal. So I make a diagonal cut, and again, they're filled with pulsing gradients. And I can keep cutting, but there's a limit to the amount of cuts. So there's a number of cuts. Now, if I cut here, you lose another cut. So this area opens up again. So that's the difference, one of the differences between the two pieces. The next website is likethisforever.com in the Allen and Overy collection. It's a flower that keeps opening. There's petals. And the petals are filled with a gradient to suggest a three-dimensionality and an overlap, but still being a monocolor flower. And they grow from the middle. They grow and they start so small that you don't see them, and then they just grow out from the middle. And the leaves in the background that are a little bit behind start to shrink again, so you don't see them disappear. So if you look at this petal, it's moving a little bit towards the center. So the top layers are moving to the outside, up to a point, and then they shrink back to the middle. And that way you get the suggestion of the infinite growing flower. And at the same time, the color of the petals changes every so many seconds. And if you click, you speed up the changing. So there's a set of, I think, 5 colors that you can choose from. And the piece will scale proportionately. I'm not showing you every website how it scales, but I'll especially show it if it scales in an interesting or different way. Otherwise, all websites just, for example, this website has a circle. It just has to scale as long as the circle stays a circle. So if I'm viewing it on a portrait-oriented device, the circle will scale from left to right. It will fill that space. If it's a square device, it'll hit all the edges. And on a rectangular, on a landscape device, it'll hit the top and the bottom. And what happens here is that we see a circle that's filled with a gradient. The gradient is used so you see the rotation, because if you fill a circle just with one color, you can't see any rotation. And then I can rotate the circle by moving my mouse in circles, and the background will move the opposite way. And I can try to make the background here, they've almost blended. And if I move again, they appear again. We think that we're moving this by moving in circles with the mouse, but it's actually left and right that makes the movement. This is intertime.us. It's another in the intertime family of works in the collection of Hugo and Carla Brown. Again, we see a pulsing gradient that's filling the screen. And if I click somewhere, it'll create 4 lines from the 4 corners onto that point where I clicked. And if I put another point, it'll create 3 lines because there were 3 corners in that area. So I can keep dividing each area into more and more triangles. And all those triangles are filled with the pulsing gradients. And this work will scale. It will be squeezed. It doesn't have to follow the original proportions. It can just adjust. If I click the first point that I clicked, it'll reset. If I click one of the later points, it'll reset that area. If I click a few points here and go to back to the first point of this area, it'll reset that whole area. The next website is Mechanical Water. It's not interactive, there's no sound. It's a depiction of a water surface in a mechanical, scripted way. And it's basically a number of lines, maybe 30 lines, that have a slight pulse or a sine wave movement, and they're moving independently, and they're moving either to the left or the right. So each line will move randomly either to the left or the right. And it's filled with a gradient from blue to white. The next website is Move Now, Think Later. It's sort of a checkers board where the game of checkers is played, but the board is flexible in size. A normal checkers board is, I think, 10 by 10 areas, but here it really depends on your screen. It just adapts. And it will just play according to the rules of checkers. So it'll eat the white and the black, try to eat each other. And once it's done, once it's run fully, it just restarts the game. So this is violentpower.com. We see a room. The room is filled with 5 colors. I think, again, there's a list of 10 colors that it can choose from. So if I refresh the website, there's always a different combination. And then if I click once, the walls of the room will start to fold. This wall will fall on this side, or this wall will fall on this side, or whatever. And every time this wall falls, you'll hear a sort of karate sound of someone being hit. You hear the you hear the sort of swoosh of the fast movement in the hit, and then it just picks a random wall and picks a random movement out of all the preset movements. So this wall could either go this way or that way or that way. This wall could go here or here or there. So each wall has three options and this one has four options. The next website is called Inner Doubts. This is a very compositional sort of study where it divides the screen into squares and then it creates a path, and this path will have a full spectrum gradient, and every time you click it rearranges the path, so it creates a maze and you can follow it. And this is the speed at which it should move. The next website is called Open This Window, a collection of Mark Rossman, and we see sort of a suggestion of a landscape, simplified with gradients, and then nothing happens if you move your mouse, but if you drag from left to right or right to left, you open the window, and the further you open it, the more you hear the sound of nature outside. And then you can close it again, and then it's quiet again. We also made it so it kind of snaps back into position, so you don't just leave it. It's easy to snap it back. The next website is called Looking at Something, and you can change the weather. If you have your mouse somewhere in the top area, the weather's really nice and you hear birds. And the further you go down, the darker the weather gets, the more rain. And if you go down all the way, there's lightning. And the lightning is suggested by a flash of white, and the sound of lightning, and there's the sound of rain. The further you go up, the less rain drops. The further you go down, the more rain drops. There's a flash version, and there's an HTML5 version. The browser will play the flash version if there's a flash plugin. If there isn't, it will play the HTML5 version. And on the HTML5 version, on a touchscreen, there's no mouse. So it's basically, if you drag down, the weather will go down. And if you drag up, the weather will go more towards the up weather. The next website is randomfear.com. There's no sound. It's an interactive website that keeps generating compositions. There's a number of sizes of rectangles. There's a preference of how many small ones, how many large ones, and the margins are random. But these are all parameters that I play with. And then every time it sort of listens to those parameters and gives one option that rule makes. So I can make it so it's mostly small rectangles, or it could be that it's mostly big rectangles. In this case, this is the composition that comes out within my rules. And if you move the mouse, it speeds it up a lot. So you start seeing all the options very quickly. And then if you stop, it pauses for a second. The next website is ifyesno.com. We see the screen divided into many areas, and each area is filled with a gradient. If I move the mouse around, same as the previous website, it speeds up the choices. The rules here of composition, it makes a big cut and then makes smaller cuts, but where it puts the cut is not exactly the middle. So intertime.com was based on cutting everything in half in the middle. This is more cutting it in half in a random point, so it creates a different type of composition. And if you don't do anything, it makes a choice every so many seconds for you. But if you want to speed it up, you move your mouse around. The next website is hexattack.com. It's very simple. There's two rectangles, and each is filled with a random color at a certain interval. And the script makes it so that you're not going to have the same color in the rectangle or in the background at the same time. So they're kind of separated. Welcome back. We had a little break. The next website is ifnoyes.com, collection of Benjamin Palmer and Elizabeth Vallow. The screen is divided into multiple lines that each are moving at a center point, and they're rotating. So each line has a center point, an axis on which it rotates, and then the content of all the areas that are created by the different lines. The different lines will cut the screen, and in between are areas that each have a gradient that rotates as well. And then the idea is that if I move my mouse right to left, the content of the areas rotates faster. And if I move my mouse up and down, the rotation of the line speeds up. And so if you're rotating your mouse like this, it just feels sort of chaotic and kaleidoscopic. And this is the stasis, the calm state, and this is the playback speed, which it should be. And then when you speed up, it looks like this. The next website is futureisuncertain.com, and we see a road, and the road has different color areas with random intervals from a pre-selected set of colors. And if I move my mouse towards the top of the screen, the movement is much faster, there's more shaking, and if I move my mouse down, things slow down and there's not so much shaking. This is nothingeverhappens.com. It's a graphic representation of water. Graphic meaning that I reduced it to lines and I reduced it to black and white so that we can make something that's generative and works well in code and works well on any device. It's just a very simplified version of a normal natural phenomenon, a reflection of water, of light in water. And the way it's made is that there's a number of lines that each have sort of a sine movement. So when I say sine movement, I mean there's a center line and there's points that move back and forth, and in between those points, there's curves are drawn. And then when the lines overlap, it will, in the in-between areas, choose between black and white. This is one of those things that I know how I made it, but I can't really put it to words. I know how I drew it, but then how it was made in code, I'm not sure, and then I just play with the numbers. So Rainier makes something in code based on drawings that I make, and then I just play with the numbers till I'm happy. So this is the playback speed that I like. This is the amount of black and white that I like. So if it ever has to be recoded, please look at this. The next set is called Maybe What. It's a slow movement. There's a number of triangles. The triangle is based on the height of the browser, and then it gets smaller and smaller as the triangle moves to the right, but it only shrinks in its width. The height always stays the same. So it's as if this triangle is being pushed from the previous one or the next one, and it's like there's new people coming back to squeeze the next people, and they get squeezed until they're invisible, until they're so thin here at the end that they disappear. This is everythingalwayseverywhere.com in the collection of Annette Doms. Is it a seascape or a landscape? I don't know. But it's a number of rectangles, each filled with a gradient. This gradient is slightly different than this one. So the white here is a bit brighter than the white here. And then this is the opposite movement of what we just saw in Maybe What, where in Maybe What, the large shapes were pushing the smaller shapes closer to the horizon and closer to invisibility. In this case, we're moving from the center, from the horizon here, and the shapes will grow. And sort of that creates the illusion as if you're flying over a landscape. So there's an ease function in the growth that you can see in the code. Usually, I don't work with linear movement. And when I say linear, I mean every second it moves the same amount of pixels. In this case, there will be an algorithmic balance where it either moves more in the beginning or more towards the end to create the illusion and the feeling of an even movement. But many times a mathematically even movement doesn't look even. When something is growing, there might be an ease in or an ease out, and then it'll feel more regular or more smooth. This is ifeelstrange.com in the Borisan collection. I created a number of shapes in a website that we previously saw, the beefchickenpork.com. So it's this library of shapes of about 20. And I've been using these shapes over and over in different works. It's my grammar of shapes. And these shapes here are overlapping each other. And when they overlap each area, it chooses either the foreground color or the background color, so either blue or red. And you can grab the shapes, they start to wobble, and you can move them around. It's really, I'm looking for a sort of an investigation of the tools that I use, and I like using vector shapes for their scalability and the infinity of resolution as sort of the simplest way of making computer imagery that works across many platforms and across the network. Because they're vector shapes, they're small in size. So please note that most of my works are under 200 kilobytes, and this work is probably 10 kilobytes. So that's always been interesting to me to make something that fits easily on the network, even now that network speeds are so high that might not even matter, but still you load the website and it's very instant. It's not like a video, and there's no compression because it's an infinite image, a vector image. And so the behavior of all the pieces, they move around and create compositions by overlapping. You see this shape is overlapping the previous ones, and then it's almost like you see through the shape. If I move this shape here, wherever they overlap, it'll create a hole. This is slowempty.com. There's a bit of sound, and there's a triangle in the middle. And from the points of the triangle, there are points towards the edges of the screen. And the lines in between, it's almost like there's rubber bands between the triangle and the edges of the screen. And the triangle is moving, and it keeps pulling the rubber bands further. And whenever you click, you will put the triangle there. And the triangle will be smaller or bigger sometimes, and it'll move clockwise or counterclockwise. And there's a set of colors that I chose. There's black, green, pink, blue, and the triangle is always gray. And so that's in the Cervez family collection, Slow Empty. FillThisUp.com in the KRC collection. We have a white website, and whenever you move your mouse, it keeps creating more and more shapes. So this is again that same library of shapes filled with a number of gradients. And then at an interval, pretty quickly, it keeps putting new shapes on top of the other ones. One thing that you should note is that this was made in JavaScript and Canvas, the Canvas tag. All my JavaScript pieces are made with the Canvas tag. And the Canvas tag has a property where you can take a shape and draw it and then just leave it there as a bitmap, so the computer doesn't have to think about it anymore. If this was made in Flash, it would be harder because Flash kind of wants you to, that all the pieces on the stage are still there and you can still manipulate them. In this case, once the piece is on the stage, once it's viewable, the whole background becomes one background image. It's no longer a dynamic image. That means that I could not make a function now and say, I want to delete a certain shape that's on the stage. They're all there. But what I can do is when I drag, I do the opposite and I just put white shapes on top of the colored shapes. So that way I can clean it up. But if you would do this and you would have all the shapes active, meaning that they could be manipulated later, if you keep doing it, there would be so many shapes on the stage that the computer would run out of memory, because it can add up to the tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands. If you would, it's one of those things in scripting where you can make a script that crashes if you allow it to make too many objects. But this way, by making the background into a static image, you don't have that problem. So here I can fill it up again. So whenever I move my mouse without holding it down, I'm adding shapes. And whenever I drag with the mouse pressed down, I'm deleting shapes by painting over it with white. But it's not paint, I'm just throwing shapes on top of each other, either white shapes or colored shapes. The next website is flyingfrying.com. It's a fried egg floating in a white space. There's a yellow circle with a highlight that's sort of rotating. And then there's a white circle around it. There's no line around the circle, just a drop shadow. And this is a similar script to Sad for Japan, the website, a similar kind of movement where there's points on the circle and they each move a little bit independently, but they stay within a parameter of a circle. So it still looks like a circle shape. This website is not interactive. The next website is interactive and it has sound. It's called deepsadness.com in the collection of the Ameri family. And we see a shape. There's a shape in the foreground and there's a background color. And if I click, what happens is every time you click, you choose a new shape, you choose a new foreground color, you choose a new background color, and there's a sound. And there's a number of pre-selected colors, there's a number of pre-selected shapes, there's a number of sounds, I think 12 sounds, the 12 notes of the scale. And then you can move very quickly or slowly, but it's all random. So there's no way you can control any idea of a melody. You can control the rhythm and the pace, but the melody is random. And the contrast between the colors or the color combinations is also random. This is openthatwindow.com. It's a variation of open this window. Open this window was a sideways movement. This is a top to bottom movement. Open this window was the countryside, and this is more like a big city. So you hear city noise. You can close it again. This is pinkyellowblue.com. It's not interactive and there's no sound. It's just slow movement of two shapes. If I refresh, you see the colors are different. There's three colors to choose from, pink, yellow, and blue. And the shapes move very slowly and they bounce on the edges of the screen. And whenever the shapes hit each other, all the colors change, all the colors swap. So the three colors are reallocated across the three elements. So it's about to hit. And the moment it hits, the three colors change. And then they keep bouncing around. That's all they do. This is slickquick.com. There's a circle that moves across the screen. And every so many frames, or every so many milliseconds, it makes the next step. And it leaves a trace, it just leaves copies of itself. So the circle is continuously copying itself across a path. The path is based on the edges of the screen, so the circle moves somewhere from the middle and starts moving at a certain direction, and as soon as it hits the screen, it'll change its direction within the parameters of the code. And whenever I click, the circle will change color. So there's a number of pre-selected colors, and then it starts to copy itself again and again. So if I click quickly, you'll see many different colors on top of each other. It starts to look like tubes, but they're just copies of circles. So if you look closely at the tubes, you can see a little bit of like scales on a worm, but you can see that it's separate circles, it's not a line. And if you double-click, you start from scratch. Roomwarp.com in the collection MW. It's again an abstraction of a room filled with color. And if I move the mouse, the perspective changes, or the room is warping and there's sound as well. The direction of the movement, basically there's a number of preset compositions that it morphs between. So I made a number of angles that I like, and those are endpoints of the animation. The animation is in steps between those points that I chose. So I made, let's say I made 20 rooms, and there's movements between those 20 rooms. So it will pick randomly the next still. It's never really still, it's always shaking a bit. blackgrayblack.com. There's two sign movements, one horizontal and one vertical. And wherever they overlap, it's either black or white, a gray or white, gray or black, sorry. Gray or black, because it's called black, gray, black. Yeah, duh. And if I press the mouse, it speeds up and it starts to shake. It's a little bit like TV static, but it's zoomed in very far. Or simplified. We have noifyes.com. This is similar to a previous website, and here the screen is also divided by lines, but the lines stop at the edge and then change. You see the line here, it hits the edge and then, well, it's hard to show you. The difference is that with the previous website that I showed, the lines move out of the screen, and here they bounce at the edge of the screen. And then it's the same thing where if I move, oh no, it is. It's just the more you move, the wilder it gets, the faster it moves. And if I click, I change the color and I change the composition. The next website. thisthatnow.com. It's again, it's a website without sound, with interaction. The interaction is that if I press down, the screen is black. It gives you a rest. Other than that, it's a vector composition of a line bouncing at the edge, then continuing at a different angle, and it bounces at the edge again. The animation is simply just different instances of the same script. There's not any smooth animation in between. They're just hard renderings of the script, of the rules. We say, okay, the line can bounce this many times and then it has to go back to itself. How many different compositions? There's an infinite amount of compositions you can make with that. And so you're seeing a lot of instances after each other. This is innerinterior.com. The screen is divided into three areas. And then each area is filled with a grayscale, with a tone of gray. And if I click here, it will make a point, and it'll divide that in three again, but that point will also start moving as if you're zooming in. So it feels a bit like you see an architectural space, corridors or ceilings or corners of a room. And wherever you click, it will bring that point to the center. So if I click far away, if I click here, it will move that original point to the center. If I click here, it's just a little bit of movement because I was already close to the center. And so it's always dividing it into three areas. One, two, three. I click here, one, two, three, with three grayscales. The grayscales are random. There's not an idea of a light source. It just works randomly. And again, if I click far away from the middle, there's more movement. And you get bigger areas. If I click close to the middle, you get smaller areas. If I here now, I'm tapping repeatedly. And again, if I just click far away, then there's a bigger area. The next website is homagetothe.com. It's based on Homage to the Square by Joseph Albers. What we see is there's a rectangle, which is the size of the browser, which is different for every user. Maybe for some users, it's on their phone. It might look like this. And this rectangle is black, and it's slowly morphing into a white square. And so what happens is the black rectangle that is the size of the browser is moved to the center, and as it's moving, it's fading to white. The content of the rectangle is becoming lighter and lighter, and is becoming more and more square. So it's at the end point, it's actually the end point of it becoming square is already around where my cursor is here, because after that it fades so much that it becomes invisible. If it would be a square at the end of the movement, it would still look too rectangular here. So I made a point that it becomes a square a little bit earlier than the end of the color fade. The color fade is from black to maybe 20% gray. The next website is syncslow.com, which we're not going to watch the full duration, but it's a sun that's slowly sinking into the horizon. And it takes about 4 minutes, because that's about how long it takes from when the sun hits the horizon until it's gone. So as you can see, it's slowly just sinking. And you can watch it on syncslow.com. Remotelydistant.com is a sort of simplification of the parallax phenomenon, that things move quicker if they're closer to you. So what we see is a repeated visual, a repeated gradient that's shown bigger and bigger the closer it gets to you, and the movement closer to you is faster than the movement in the background. It's basically a diagram of parallax movement. Oozmove.com is a website that is kind of a drawing in reverse. So normally when you draw, you're drawing over what you previously drew, but here the drawing is in a way shrinking. So the drawing is retreating. It's like a worm that moves back into the earth. What it is in actuality is it's a number of circles that is on a path, and the path is randomized. There's a script at how often it curves, how often it changes its angle. And then on that path, there's color points. And so you can see little instances of circles. That's the resolution, in a way. That's how often there are steps between the color points. And then as the worm is retreating, it's extending in the back. So if you wait, you can see it sometimes that it's here, like it pops up in the back. This is neogeocity.com in the collection of Jeremy Bailey and Kristen Schaefer. We see a simplification of a metropolis, a big city filled with buildings and roads. All these buildings are just rectangles that were made three-dimensional. So there's a floor plan of rectangles, similar to randomfear.com, where I have the parameters of small to big rectangles, either vertical or horizontal. And then there's a random depth to the blocks. And so it's kind of the idea of an app like Google Maps, where you can just pan across a city. And in this case, the city is completely infinite. You can scroll as far as you want, left or right. It never stops. And the other thing is that if you don't do anything, it'll just move on its own. It'll move in the direction that you pull it in, and it'll just continue in that movement. And if you click once, it goes into night mode. And night mode is a wireframe. It's all the rectangles at the bottom of the floor, plus the lines that extend to the top. But it doesn't show the rectangle of the top. So it kind of feels like grass, neon grass coming out of the floor. And if you use the scroll function of your mouse, it's not doing that. You can go quickly between day mode and night mode. There's the whole website is using a custom 3D engine, because the WebGL again produced a blurry line on the edges of each building, so I wanted it to be sharp. And that's why the 3D engine was built custom in Canvas and JavaScript. There are some errors sometimes, so you can see that there's strange overlaps of buildings if you watch closely. I'm going to try to find an example. I don't understand completely because I'm not a coder, but there's an error in the sense that it's not true 3D. They're really just shapes overlapping in two-dimensional space, and then sometimes that doesn't work with the 3D illusion. So if you look for it, you might find errors, and maybe in the future we can fix this bug. This is softslow.com. We see a movement of gradients from a center, a sort of horizon. The horizon is always dark, but the gradient points behind it can change color, and then it kind of gives the illusion of driving towards a dark horizon. This is yesnoif.com. The screen is filled with a gradient from dark blue to white. And if I click somewhere, it divides the screen in five planes, and that dividing point disappears. It moves outside of the screen. It moves away from the center. And if I keep tapping, you can keep dividing everything. So, and everything keeps zooming in. You can either call it zooming in, or the points are moving out. It kind of feels like you're moving towards the center with a camera. It just keeps going. There's a little bit of movement of all the planes from each other. You see that this one moves a little faster than what's outside. A lot of things, I don't remember why we did it that way, but sometimes that extra movement matters. Like, it just felt still without it. So you saw that this moves a little bit more. This is trying.com. It's the reverse of falling. So in this case, the rectangles, the movement is upwards and the sound is upwards. The other one was very negative, it was very downwards. Nevernowhere.com is a very simple website. We see a number of circles across a colored background, and we hear sounds. So there's a few parameters. There's the position of the circle, there's the number of circles, there's the background color, foreground color, and the tone. And it will just continuously evaluate all those options and make a rhythm randomly. So it'll decide, okay, next frame I'm changing either the position or the number, or I'm only changing the tone, or I'm only changing the color, or I'm changing all of them. So it's a constant evaluation of these variables, and which one do I change next, or do I just wait a while? This is silentsilence.com in the collection of the Museum of the Image in Breda. What we see is a number of lines dividing the screen, and again, the areas between the lines are filled with gradients. The gradients are always black with another color. So if I click, it's blue and black, red and black, green and black, purple and black, or blue and black. And the lines are all rotating a little bit, but they're also moving downwards. So if you do this, you hardly notice the downward movement if you're moving your mouse. But if you wait around a little bit, you see that everything is not only rotating, but also falling down. The next website is called Trash Loop, and it's a corner of a room with a trash can and a piece of trash, maybe a paper that was crumbled and left on the floor, and then you can throw it in the trash can. But if you wait, the trash can spits it out again, and it will spit it in a different direction every time. So it's random. I don't know if it's going to go left or right. This is again the same movement as in Deep Black Hole, where we have to convert two-dimensional input, because a mouse is two-dimensional, is either up, down, left, right, and we have to sort of create a three-dimensional illusion from that. So I'm dragging it upwards, so we're assuming you want to go deeper in the room, but that will always be kind of clumsy. This is infinitething.com. It's a line, and the line is a loop, so it hits itself again. It moves randomly, and the filling of the line is a gradient from blue to purple to another blue to white, and it's moving across the line as if it's a liquid that's going through a tube, through a transparent tube. Every time I click, the line regenerates, so it's basically, the script is drawing for us, and we can keep evaluating the drawings. So we can look at this drawing, or we can look at this drawing. Again, it's a number of parameters, and the script behaves within those parameters. And then one thing that was kind of a coincidence is that if you move, resize the browser, it redraws very quickly, quicker than you could if you were tapping. So it's nice to view it this way. This is floatbounce.com. We have a rotating background. I usually use gradients for the properties of, it's the easiest way to show rotation. If I would use anything else, I would have to use a figure to show rotation. But gradients are very useful for filling an area with something that doesn't have too much meaning, and you can just focus on the movement. And so then I can, wherever I click in the empty area, I'll create a circle, and they'll start bouncing against each other, and they're each rotating. If I click on the circles themselves, they disappear. So the circles bounce at the edges, and they bounce at each other. The bounce does not influence the rotation of the circle. That was an option that we looked at, but I decided it was better this way. This is called This Empty Room. It's a collection of the Museum for Linda. It's not interactive, it's just a suggestion of a room. I like to call these suggestions because it's a diagram. So a diagram is sort of a universal symbol of something, but it doesn't really try to be realistic. And what we see here is there's a room, and it has a door opening, and it has two windows. And through that, we see the horizon. And that means there's many different planes. There's this plane, this one, there's a rug on the floor, there's the floor itself, and each plane is filled with a different color, and those colors pulse between another set of pre-selected colors. So this one goes from green, right now this area is green, and then it'll fade to light green, this is fading to red, from blue to red. So each area is pulsing, and sometimes the neighbor areas are almost the same color. The sky and the ground outside are connected. So this area and this area and this area are always the same color. If they're fading, they're fading together. This one and this one and this one, they're fading together. All the areas are fading. The website will scale. It will completely squeeze with the preferences of the user. This is unknown landscape. It's a horizon, a sort of hill, and there's a background color and a foreground color, and they also fade. And it has a bit of a smart resize script where it will resize up to a point, but if it gets too narrow, it will start cropping it, because otherwise the line didn't look good. So that's in the script, and otherwise it's just pulsing at a random interval. This is herethat.com. It's a little bit similar to the pink, yellow, blue, where there's a number of shapes that are moving slowly. But there's a blur on top of it, so you don't see where one shape begins and the other shape ends. And when the shapes hit each other, they swap colors. One note here is that this CSS property of blurring works in all browsers except Internet Explorer. Maybe now in Microsoft Edge it's fine. So as of now, it works well. That's one of the few pieces that has a problem in Internet Explorer. This is crossdivisions.com. The screen is divided into different areas, and each area has this X across, and the four areas that are created by that X have a gradient that sort of creates a cone, as if you're looking into a cone, a rectangular cone. And then the areas are squeezing each other. So this line is squeezing down, it's squeezing all these other areas. Now this line is moving up, it's squeezing this one, but then this one is squeezing that way. It's just continuously, everything's pushing each other. There's no interaction except for the color change. But the movement is completely on its own. There's no... These are the same colors as in silence. This is terminalobject.com. There's a shape and there's a background and there's purple and there's blue. And they fade in and out. And that way, sometimes the background and the foreground are the same. And whenever they're the same, the shape changes. So it's playing a little bit with the after image of your eye. So you still see the previous shape in an after image, but the next shape already arrives. This was also a thing where I thought a linear fade between the two would be fine, but it turned out that, and I don't remember if it was ease in or ease out, but that was better. It created a better sensation. So it's not a linear movement. This is floatingthe.com. There's a number of shapes based on torn paper. And the shapes, there's five pre-selected pastel colors, and it keeps adding shapes on top, and all the shapes move toward the center. And so it feels a bit like pieces of paper moving towards the center and then pausing. And because of all the torn shapes, it keeps creating a lot of different shapes in between. Now this is somethingopen.com. What happens here is that it keeps dividing all the areas, like in Into Time, but it's also the entire composition is growing, it's scaling, it's getting bigger. And so the division of the shapes has a preference. It will happen more likely closer to the center. It happens sometimes outside of the center, but it mostly happens in the center. And the idea is that as the whole composition is growing, but it's getting divided again in the middle, the whole balance of the composition stays the same. So it feels like you're making the image bigger, but because it keeps being divided, the overall image stays the same. This is new, old, hot, cold. This is also compositions. There are major areas and minor areas. So the major areas are growing. Inside the major area, there's an expansion of shapes, but then the major areas are pushing each other, so they will shrink. I hope you get it. It's hard to put to words, but the colors are blinking and the areas are pushing each other out of the way. Here you see it. The left one is pushing everything else. And this is the final website, number 103 so far. Thank you for listening. I hope this helps in the future. And this website is called Blank Windows. We have a suggestion of browser windows or file windows or system windows, whatever you want to call them. They're rectangles with a drop shadow. There's a parameter of a smallest one and a largest one, but they're all a little bit different. They're random. And if I see one that's in the background and I click there, it will move to the foreground. So I can keep looking for ones in the background and moving them to the foreground. That's the normal behavior in a system window. Whenever you click on a window, even if it's in the background, it'll jump up. It will ask for your attention, so that's why it moves up. And then what I can do, if I grab the center of a window, I can move it. So I can put it somewhere else, just like you would in a Finder or a Explorer or whatever your system software is called. And so I can move them around. And if I go to the corners of each window, I can resize them, just like you would with a system window. If I'm in this corner, this is not the corner, this is a side. So then I move the side, and this way I move the corner. And I can even make them very big, and then it just covers up the rest. So now I can't take anything to the foreground because this one is dominating the rest, but I can move this one and then. Okay, well, this was the final website. We've seen 103. This is August 2016 at the LIMA Institute in Amsterdam. And that was it. Thank you for listening and viewing, and see you next time.